Thank you, Tony. Research for safety, research for the market. The car they claim that can mean anything. Sporting? Well, semi-sporting coupe. Family? Small family saloon. And compact, that's true, estate. Vauxhall tell you it's whatever you want it to be. Yet, as with any vehicle that tries to achieve extremes of compromise, it could so nearly qualify for the Jack of All Trades Master of None award. Nearly, but not for very many customers who've been taking to the all-round versatility of the Chevette. Indeed, in a very short space of time, really, it's become Vauxhall's largest volume seller. Just in time, really, too, because the Viva's certainly been losing ground, particularly to Ford's new Escort. Having to fulfil so many entirely different needs, in a way it's surprising that the Chevette's British styling actually comes off. But it does. It's not at all awkward, is it? You land up with a very streamlined estate, starting with its droop snoot front end, obviously borrowed from Vauxhall's recent, considerable and successful racing involvement. However, I personally don't rate the styled headlights. They're not all that good at night, and they're just waiting to scoop up and retain all the dirt, not to mention the snow. The motor, our old Viva friend, the 1256cc four-cylinder, disappointing technically, a bit dull perhaps, only the valves overhead. But nonetheless, it is thoroughly proven, and as I saw on the last Total Economy drive, at least capable, with concentration, of 45.3 miles per gallon. Brakes, a disc drum layout, servo-assisted with dual circuits, very effective, front-end suspension independent with coil springs and an anti-roll bar. At the back, though, ye old live axle, but coil-sprung and with an anti-roll bar. As far as the luggage space goes, with the rear seat in the usual position, you have 12 cubic feet. But with it folded forward like so, a state car form 35 cubic feet. That's not bad, but with the fuel tank and the spare wheel beneath there, any high luggage does tend to restrict the rear view mirror. Another thing is the criminal will can see exactly what you've got in the back. What it ideally needs is some sort of pullover tonneau cover device to hide things away. On the L version, you get opening rear quarter lights, which I think are absolutely essential. Two doors only, and on the L you also get cloth upholstery. Ample leg and headroom inside, considering the sloping rear to the roof, is not too bad in the back either. I like the lane change position on the indicators, the competition type steering wheels just right, very comfortable, and the intermittent wipe facility, and that's additional to your two-speed wiper and electric screen wash. But a couple of not so good points: the seats, they take far too long to recline, and the safety release button under the column here, that's to prevent you being able to accidentally withdraw your keys on the move, thus operating the steering lock, they can prove extremely painful for the knees. The price, £150 more than the standard Viva two-door. Most people, though, will be buying the Chevette L, like this, which costs £1,742. On the road, a very commendable lack of road noise gets through. And apart from the very high standard of finish, certainly on the test models I've tried, I suppose the best feature has to be the handling. It's way above average for this size of car. Very well balanced suspension, steering and braking. And obviously at last, Opel Kadett influence has had its effect. The drive-in verdict? The Chevette is the best Vauxhall for years.